This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning from us, as well as this beautiful male elephant in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve in South Africa. This is Safari Live. So the sun is going to shine today. There's only a few clouds in the sky. I am Noelle, and on camera I have Senzo. Good morning, Senzo. There's the three fingers. All right. So this is an exciting day for me because it's not raining. Yesterday afternoon when we had the private rehearsal, it was raining something hectic. We had a great sighting of wild dogs and some great sightings of elephants, but I'm super excited about our male elephant that we have just to the left-hand side of our vehicle because he is a big, beautiful male with huge, huge, huge tusks. Now, don't forget, we are live. We are interactive. You can follow us hashtag safariLIVE on Twitter, or you can send through questions on the YouTube chat. So before he meanders off, I think let's have another look at those beautiful tush of his. They're quite long, they're quite thick. I would imagine they're about the thickness of my arm. And I'm trying to think of dimensions. Sorry, guys, you're going to hear a vehicle in the background. We are on the access of Vuyatela, so this is where the staff go through. So just excuse that sound very briefly. And we are just going to have to... Oh, nope, we're fine. We don't need to reposition. They've realized exactly what we're doing. But notice how he stopped. He's listening a little bit. That's called displacement behavior, where he's picking up his trunk and smelling, but hiding the fact that he's smelling it a little bit. He's put his grass just in the little crook just so he can decide whether or not he's going to move or if he's going to finish eating. And it looks like he's going to finish eating. Look how dexterous those two little finger-like appendages on the end of his trunk are. I love elephants. Look, I love everything, but a big elephant like this. Sense, can we maybe focus in on the bottom side of his trunk where he's putting the grass in his mouth there? And then pull up just a little bit. Look at that. Do you see how thick that trunk is? And then when he takes it, he very deftly picks up that grass, very, very deftly, and puts it very precisely in his mouth to grind between his teeth. Now, while this guy decides if he's going to stay or if he goes, let's head on over to Steph, who's on bushwalk, who would like to say good morning.
What an awesome way to start a morning like this with a big elephant bull like that, and a very good morning to you. My name is Steph Winterbull, and on camera today we've got Jean-Ray. And today is actually a lovely day. Yesterday was very wet. It was a big rainy day, and we ended up absolutely soaked by the time the sun went down yesterday. My shoes are in actual fact still sopping wet. As you can see, my feet are nice, all swollen and wrinkled as they get when you spend too much time in the water, which is fine. It gives you this weird way of, it feels like I'm walking around on an air carpet. Now, we are looking for some wild dog this morning. We've had them on the property the whole of yesterday. And by property, I mean this portion of the Kruger National Park where we walk around and drive around on has got... boundaries to it, if I can call it to that way. They're not physical boundaries. It doesn't stop the animals from going wherever they like, but it is a boundary nonetheless, one that we can't move across. And wild dogs have a massive range. We're looking at about 400 square kilometers, which is a couple of hundred miles. per pack of dogs. And when wild dogs come into your area, it's always exciting. They tend to bombshell an area and all the animals go crazy and the dogs run up and down, and it's a lot of excitement from the safari guide's point of view. And so we're going to see if we can find them for you today, or at least find where they've gone for you today. And so we're holding thumbs for that, at least anyway. For the rest, it's going to be a beautiful sunrise. The sun is rising up above the clouds right now. We've got high clouds, wispy ice clouds right up in the top layers of the atmosphere. And then in the east, where the sun is rising now, we've got this ominous bank of clouds. And our rain comes from the south and the east. And this is our rainy season. And we haven't had a lot of rain this year at all, to be honest with you. I was trying to see how much rain we had yesterday when I was trying to do the tallies up in my head, and I don't even think we've had 100 millimeters of rain yet. We've got 3 months left of rain, and we need to get to between 400 millimeters and 650 millimeters of rain to have an average year of rain here, and we haven't even got one quarter of the rain that we need yet, which is a bit of a worry, but luckily it's still early days, and you know, never know what could happen. Let's go put ourselves in a place where we can watch the sunrise. I definitely think it's going to be well worth it. And while I'm at it, I thought that this was alive, but it doesn't. It is still alive. That's incredible. This is a massive zebra wood. So zebra wood is a tree that we commonly find out of here, or find here when it's small. We hardly ever find any large zebra woods. And the large zebra woods that we do find are generally speaking dead and have been dead for quite some time, and I don't quite know what kills them. It's either fire or drought. They long-lived trees. They are the second hardest of all the woods that we find out here. And this is an enormous tree that you can see has been knocked down by an elephant. But it's still growing. There's still some leaves growing over there. It's quite nice. Wow. All right. We're going to sit here and wait for the sun to come up so that we can show you what it looks like. In the meantime, you're off to Noel, who apparently left that big elibu.
Hello. Okay, so we have left our big, beautiful bull elephant, for now at least. We might go back to him. I just want to check on the hyena den. I know everybody's always interested to know how our little hyena cubs are doing. So we are meandering that way, but I'm also doing kind of what Steph is doing, and I'm checking around for tracks of the wild dogs. We had a pack that was up and down and here and there, and they ran through camp, and then they were running around camp, and then they were at the dam, and then they were north of the dam, and then they were in the Milwaukee, and then they were everywhere. And they were hunting, and they were this, and they were that. They got chased by some wildebeest. It was absolute insanity. I beat up Wendy a little bit yesterday. Sorry, Wendy, we do love you. So yeah, it was absolutely insane. So we're hoping to help recreate some of the amazing action that we had with them if we can find them. So right now we're just coming up the little two-track. A two-track is a little road that we make two special things like den sites. So two-track just being the two tires on a track and then leaving that there. So I'm just gonna get a little bit quiet now, and we're just gonna have a look-see to see if our cheeky little hyenas are out. I just want to approach as slowly and quietly as I can. Peek around the corner and see if they're out and about yet. Now, it might be a little bit too wet and a little bit too chilly for them. They might need to wait until the sun is out. You never know. Yesterday was very, very cold, but what I have seen is I have seen some very fresh hyena tracks coming away from the den, adult tracks. So the adults have definitely been here. So it's entirely possible that our cubbos are just resting inside. I just want to wait a minute or two. They might get curious by our sounds or our smells. They are aware of who we are and what we do and how we are in the world. Oh, Senzo, the Dicrostachys is flowering. Do you see these pink flowers here? Just here in front of me. Beautiful. So This is a sickle bush, and it's the time of year when they flower, so these flowers are a little bit beraggled. But you see that brilliant little light pink color and then a bit of yellow? They're pink like this to attract pollinators, and then once the flower's been pollinated, those pink parts turn white. The sickle bush is also called a Chinese lantern tree because the flowers, when they're not all rain-soaked, look like little Chinese lanterns. Now, these trees have what's known as a spine on them. There you can see those spines beautifully. A spine is a modified branch as opposed to a thorn, like you would see on an acacia tree, which is a modified leaf. Now, you can chew these leaves and swallow the juices, and it helps get rid of toothache as well as tummy problems. Very similar to a silver cluster leaf, which those of you who have been watching the show for a long time have heard us talk about. Now, while I'm busy waiting to see if the cheeky hyenas come out, why don't we head on over to Ralph, who's bumbling around the other side of Djuma, and he would like to say good morning.
Good morning, everybody. And welcome on the morning game drive. And what a fantastic morning it is. Beautiful sunrise. My name is Ralph Kirsten, and on the camera we have Viam. So folks, we've just come out here at Chitwa Dam. We've just arrived. It's been an evening and an afternoon yesterday of a lot of rain. And this morning, as you could have seen, the sun looks like it's going to come out. It's cleared up quite nicely. But with all that rain, the ground has been totally soaked. So it's actually been fantastic rains. It's not just one of those surface runoff rains. It's been a lovely rain that would have helped raise the water table. And it's also it's made it fantastic for a new clean slate of tracking. So this morning, Viam and I have decided to run a little bit on the boundary lines and see if we can see of any animals that have moved into our property, because yesterday afternoon it was quite apparent that apart from the wild dogs moving around camp, quite difficult to follow, the cats seem to have left the property a little bit. So we want to see what has moved back inside. So starting here at Chitwa Dam, we're going to go around the back because we're not allowed to drive on any of the dam walls today. With it being so wet and soft, it's obviously the management asking us just to stay off of those roads. And there will be some roads that we will avoid as well because of the slippery, slidey nature of things today. And the way that we cut into the ground, it can really destroy some of the areas. So we're going to be steering clear of some of the roads, but we're also going to be making our best attempt at finding some of these wild cats that are walking around. At the moment, we've got some hippos in the dam that are a little bit exposed. Now, John giving us his question, do the animals hide away during a rain or like that? Well, John, they don't particularly have anywhere to hide. So sometimes they will just go behind some like rocks or trees or bushes, like we did see with the wild dogs when it was raining, when it was very windy. They were all curled up behind some bushes and just trying to get a little bit less exposed. Now, with that, John, thanks for putting through your question. Please give us your questions on hashtag safariLIVE on Twitter and join us on the YouTube live chat. Please send us all your comments and your questions. Love to get you interactive on the safari this morning. So all the birds are looking nice and fresh as well. They will be quite happy this morning that they've got a chance to dry off. Probably all doing a lot of preening and getting their oils re-established on their feathers. Look at them flapping around. You can almost feel the joy coming through of that lovely rain and now a chance to dry out. And with a little bit of cloud still around, it is making for absolutely beautiful light, beautiful colors, beautiful and fantastic for photography and videography as we are doing. So from this point, we're going to be heading around the back of Chitwa Lodge, and we're going to go and look in that area of the airstrip. It's going to be a nice clean slate for us to check for those tracks of leopard and possibly lion. But first prize would be a leopard, but let's go and see what we can find. So I'm going to start up. At the moment, we've got quite a few hippos here. But while we look for that first prize and cats and tracks, I think Steph, he's on foot. Maybe he's got some tracks and cats to show you.
Super excited. So we were waiting for our little hyena cubs to pop out, and I could hear woo, 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 which is the sounds of wild dogs. So I'm busy, hastily I should say, not busily, hastily making my way in the direction where I could hear them making those little calls. So I'm just checking the fire break, and now we are gonna come down. I can't decide in my head if we should be here or if we should be a little bit farther east. So I'm gonna check the western side first, and then we're gonna check the southern side, and then we're gonna go up the eastern side and maybe the northern side. And then it's so nice because it's not raining, which means we don't have the rain roof on, and Senzo's not in his little cave at the back, so we can look at everything. And also when the sun is shining like this, it's just, oh, it makes life so much better. Makes happy, happy, happiness. All right, so now when we're looking for things like wild dogs, because wild dogs move so quickly, and because wild dogs don't move in a relatively straight line, as most of our cats do, it takes a bit of driving quickly and then driving slowly and then stopping and then listening. It's a little bit of abruptness here and there, so just excuse any of that as we go along. And before I forget, don't forget that on the 14th of December at 10 o'clock Eastern time in the States, our show will be live. We'll be live on Nat Geo Wild for Big Cat Week. So you must put that in your diaries, yeah? Okay, I'm excited about it. I don't know if you guys are excited about it. I'm sure you are. And don't forget as well, we are live. We are interactive. You can follow us, hashtag safariLIVE on the Twitter, or give us a shout out on the YouTube chat. I haven't heard from anybody this morning, and I haven't really had a chance to talk to anyone recently because I've been in the private rehearsals, so I'm out and about this morning, so I'd really like to hear how everyone is. And Lady Starfire, if you're out there, I know Tesla made a little Christmas carol for me to sing, and I would really love to sing it for her, if you wouldn't mind sending that through so then I can make sure Tesla hears my horrible singing voice, which I know she laughs at quite often. Okay. Now, I'm not picking up any tracks yet. I do think we're a little bit too far west, but that's okay. Rather cover ground and then you know you've covered it than not cover it and have to go back and cover it again. Although that being said, with wild dogs, you can drive in circles and circles. Should have seen yesterday at one point, lazy down on the ground, and then they got up and started moving, and we were trying really hard to get through the bush, and it was just, yeah, we kept losing them and then finding them and losing them and then finding them, and oh my goodness, it was a hectic afternoon. I'm still on a high from it, but you know how I am with the wild dogs. I get way overexcited and have trouble finding my words. So for those of you that might just be joining us this morning, it might be your first time on Safari Live, wild dogs are one of the best predators hunting-wise on the continent. Their numbers are very few in comparison to other cats. So, for instance, we have roughly 20,000 wild lions left on the continent. We have roughly 7,000 cheetah left on the continent. The leopard numbers are unknown. They're very elusive. They're very hard to pin down any numbers with that. And then the wild dogs, there's only 3,500, or probably less by now, because those numbers I have are a little bit old for the dogs, left on the whole continent. And for the wild dogs, we're talking sub-Saharan Africa. They don't really exist anywhere else. Although I would be interested to know if there's any research done on North Africa, if there's possibly any historical fact that they might have been up there, because they do exist in places like the Kalahari and the Karahari Transfrontier Park, where it's very arid. And as we Sub-Saharan Africa and Northern Africa are very different climates. Northern Africa being much more arid and much having more specialized creatures that live in that aridity. Okay, but that's just my pondering thought for the day. Now, the pack we're looking for, I actually forgot to count yesterday. I believe James Richard mentioned that the pack had something to do with the Mbali breakaways. There is one male that has a collar. Oh, very cool. We've got a little bronze wing courser in the road. Senzo, I'm going to back up very slowly. Don't fly away. We usually only see coursers. There he is in the road. We usually only see coursers at night. So this little bronze wing courser is out during the day. Absolutely fantastic. I love seeing birds out of their normal context. There we go. Beautiful. It's very similar to a thickney or a dikkop, or even a plover for that matter. And I have a feeling because this morning is very cool, that is why this little bronze wing courser is out and about. Now, Lou, I believe you were chatting in my ear and saying that Ralph is possibly ready to say something more on today's safari. So let's head on over to my friend Ralph and see what he's found for us.
Yes, well, everybody, what I do have to show you are these waterbuck and the lovely coats that for the rest of the animals would have been quite miserable during the rain, but these waterbuck with their lovely coats and the lovely oil that they have helping them to be quite waterproof, it is fantastic for the waterbuck to be nicely wet, and in fact they might quite enjoy it. And while we were sitting waiting and watching these waterbuck, we've actually just heard some lions calling behind Chitwa Chitwa Lodge. So that was a very good opportune moment for us just to stop and have a look at these drying out waterbuck. And we've now heard some lions in the background. So I think without further ado, we are going to start up and quickly go race behind the lodge and see if we can catch up with them, because there was some alarm calling as well, so it is confirmed that we will be in the area, and it could be very nicely exciting if we could catch up with the lions. Now, I would also like to just have a look at a little bit of a topic today, something along the lines of instinctive behavior versus learned behavior. Now, it's nice for us to get involved in all sorts of these little topics, and if we can chat about them and comment and throw some questions around and see what everybody knows. You know, for instance, with the lions that we've just heard roaring like that, you know, would it be instinctive or would it be learned behavior? And as a result, just on our right here, you might now start to see these waterbuck reacting towards the roaring of the lion. And that for me would definitely be more so a learned behavior. From the group reacting to the noise of lions. Now, I don't think when waterbuck are born, they are instinctively scared of a lion roaring. I do think it's as a result of the others that are reacting towards it, and then the youngsters might learn from that. But to be scared obviously is an instinctive behavior, but to be scared of lion calling, I think definitely more so that of learned behavior. But this is just, obviously, we're just starting to get into this little topic. We're hearing guinea fowl calling up ahead, so I'm not going to get too much into a specific subject, but let's think along those lines. Instinctive versus learned behavior. It would be quite an interesting topic to take forward. And it sounds like everybody's starting to get excited for these lions. So let's continue. And I'm just going to move forward a little bit, and then we'll have to switch off again and just see if we can pick up any alarm calls, because those waterbuck are also now starting to pick it up. And they've either heard those lions or they've smelt them. There's very little wind moving through at the moment, so it would have been a little bit of a breeze that might have brought the smell towards them coming from the east, which is not impossible, but it would be ideal if we could be in this area and we actually hear them. It would be quite easy to catch up with them. Trista, that's a very good question this morning. What does it smell like driving around this morning and on the game drive? Well, I can tell you, it's a fantastic smell. It's very crisp, very clean. It's such a fresh, it's almost like the nicest potpourri that you could ever imagine, but so much more natural because of this clean water rain that we've had and all that freshness just coming through. That's, for me, almost that smell you get in your nose after you've brushed your teeth, something like that. All right, I'm going to continue. We're going to try and pick up with the sound of these lions, but in the meantime, let's go over to Noel, who's got one of those birds that follow lions around too.
This is definitely a bird, Ralph, that you would see after lions make a kill. This is a very, very cool vulture. This is a white-headed vulture. We don't see many in this area. It is a threatened bird. It's an endangered bird now. Yes, the numbers have plummeted hectically over the past few years, so I'm actually more excited to see this vulture right now than I am at the prospect of finding the wild dogs, and you know how much I love wild dogs. White-headed vultures are absolutely incredible. Now, one of the reasons why we don't see as many of them as we should actually has to do with the numbers of elephants in our area having an overpopulation, and the places where white-headed vultures like to make their nests is at the top of, well, one of the places is the top of knobthorn trees, and elephants love knobthorn trees. So when you have an overpopulation of elephants, you have a decrease in the population of knobthorn trees, which gives white-headed vultures less places to nest. They like the big, big, tall, tall ones. And therefore the population numbers decrease drastically. It's also had an effect on the white-backed vultures, but as far as I know, not as large an effect as with the white-headed. So this is one of those sightings where when I get done with drive, I call up friends of mine and go, yes, I saw a white-headed vulture on drive today. Look at that beautiful display of all the neck feathers there. And this is a much larger vulture compared to some of our others. I'm just going to get my little bird book out and double check the size for you so that we can chat about that a little bit more. Now, I don't know, any of you might be keeping bird lists for Djuma. I'm not sure if this is on your bird list. So it's 92 to 96 centimeters. So we're looking at about 2 foot, and then the wingspan is going to be about 2.5-3 meters. Absolutely amazing. Now, I've just had a little update in my ear. The wild dogs are busy moving east on the fire break, so I think we're going to leave this amazing sighting and head towards them. Let's see if we can find them. This is an absolutely fantastic morning, white-headed vulture. I'm so excited. Now, another thing that will affect vulture populations is hyena populations. So when hyenas chew bones, they leave little bone fragments behind. And the vultures will actually pick up those bone fragments and eat them, as well as eating the carcass. And those little bone fragments help the eggs of the vultures become hard. Not that they can't have hard eggs without them, but it is a definite add-on to their ability to nest properly. And so if the hyena population plummets, the vulture population will also plummet. Everything works in conjunction with each other. Everything works within a food chain or a food web. I prefer a food web. Everything's interconnected. Sorry, I just don't want to hit our little warthog tail on any of these trees. And I'm just going to tell the guys quickly, stations, I'm here on Galago Shortcut. I'd like to come and respond to those Mosloa. All right. Oh, I'm too excited. Sorry, we're driving into the sun. I'm a little bit blinded. But we're going to come around the corner and then get moving. And when I do come around the corner and we get through the little dip, through the drainage line, I am gonna pick up a little bit of speed. Not Ferrari safari speed, but enough speed to keep up with possibly getting these cheeky wild dogs on camera for you. So we might lose a little bit of signal here. Just stick with me in case we do. And up ahead as well. Now, because it rained so heavily yesterday, we might also get a chance to see some of our larger cats. I am hoping that Ralph manages to find those lions. The Inkahumas, most of them, as far as I know, have made it over sort of towards Elephant Plains side. I believe the Sticks are somewhere south, maybe Mala Mala. Not 100% correct on that one. Tandi, I'm sure, is close to her den somewhere. And Tingana... Oh, now the dogs are heading south on Cheetah Cutline. That's what the guys are telling me. Just want to see if we're going to be able to get around that area in time. We might actually have to change head over the dam. They're a little bit farther than I thought, so it is going to take us a little bit longer to get to that area. Maybe a good 5 or 10 minutes. So if we find anything very cool, well, everything's cool, but if we find anything super interesting to talk about along the way, we definitely will. But I'm pretty much going to be heading over there because, you know, they move very quickly. And if I don't get there quickly, we are not going to see them. Now, yesterday they were hunting. And as I said, they came through our camp. And they were hunting hunting impala and hunting nyala, and we've got two male bushbucks, one small male bushbuck and one large male bushbuck, who decided our camp was probably the safest thing, and every time one of us turned around to go to the loo, one of them was hiding in the little enclosure for the loo and watching us, like, are the dogs here? Am I going to be eaten? It was amusing, but they made it through the night. Justin, you're curious to know if I would consider wild dogs the piranhas of the bush. No, Justin, I definitely wouldn't give them the piranha name. I kind of get where you're going with the question. Piranhas attack something and they eat it very quickly, and wild dogs do the same. For me, wild dogs are a much more humane way to die, as opposed to, you know, a buffalo being eaten by a lion can take over an hour, and that animal is really suffering through that. Look, a leopard will sort of grab by the neck and by the throat, just in here. Sorry guys, it's gonna be a little bit slippery, just hang on. And sort of suffocate their prey a little bit, but wild dogs, that animal goes into shock so quickly that they barely feel anything. So I would actually call them the euthanasia predators of the bush, if I had to come up with anything. But it's an interesting thought. With the eating quickly and piranhas eat quickly, we could definitely equate those two together, Justin, for sure. Okay, so we're coming past the dam now. We are going to go over and then come around and head towards Twin Dam side and then get on to Gowrie Main and then head over to Cheetah Cutline. So let's, while I'm busy getting towards the dogs, why don't we head on over to Ralph, who's still busy tracking those lions.
Yes, everybody, we are still tracking the lions. And following with the theme that I've sort of brought in, the learned versus instinctive behavior. Now, we would have learned that watching prey species is also a good way of identifying if there's any predators around. And we've just spotted this whole herd of impala. Now, they were moving off, but they're not running off or all looking in one direction or alarm calling. So it doesn't seem like these lions are in this direct vicinity at the moment. And we've learned that by watching the impala. And we know that if they are relaxed like this, generally speaking, there wouldn't be any big predators around. Having said that, they could be close to the ground stalking them. But generally the birds would have started alarm calling, and these animals would surely have picked them up. So we're still on the trail. We're still listening out. We think we're in more or less the area where the lions were calling from. It was quite a way away from us when we heard them near to Chitwa Dam, but nonetheless, we do know which general area they're in. So we're scouring the area at the moment and just seeing if we can pick up on any of the other animals, the birds, the squirrels, anything that's going to give away their location, or if they may be raw again, that will be very easy then after that. Now that we've relocated into the specific area, we hope that they maybe give us just one more little clue. But if they don't roar again, maybe they might do a little bit of a small hunt this morning. You know, generally, if they roar in the morning like that, it can be re-establishing their territory vocally after an evening of moving around. So, and now they're getting ready to settle for the day's snooze. But that's what we've learned about lion behavior. Now we are going along the cut line and we're going right on the boundary of where we're allowed to go, and VM tells me that this is where there were two male leopards yesterday, just over the boundary, and that's why we're also quite happy to be looking in this area, because now it seems we've got a good chance of leopard and or lion. So that would be a fantastic start to the day, but we will chance our luck and see what we can find. And anything in between is always going to be a bonus. So, folks, please don't forget, throw us your comments and your questions on Twitter and on YouTube, as we would love to get you involved. Now, nothing calling out at present. I just switch the vehicle off and just freewheel downhill here a little bit, and we can listen out if these lions call again or if we hear any alarm calls. Now it is a little bit quiet. Now, John asking the question, very good question, does learned behavior become instinctual behavior for generations down the line? Now, that is a fantastic question, John, because yes, if I would say yes, because if something is done through a learned behavior for long enough, I think it can then become almost ingrained through the evolution or change of the animal to become instinctual. For instance, I mean, even suckling of young from the baby to the mother, that at some point must have been or could have started with a learned or a by chance, but then eventually having learned that was a good tactic to it could have been the mother that put the baby onto the breast or onto the mammary gland, but then later maybe it because it was ingrained so far, it became instinctual. Now, then we could also move on to the question of intelligence. How do we judge intelligence of an animal? And, you know, a very good point that I've heard a few very clever people speaking about is it's actually the ability for an animal to be able to learn. And how can you judge that? And some of them came with a good point that it's also with regards to how much your brain can grow. So from the time that when you're born to the time that when you're an adult, how much would your brain have grown? Now, humans have the largest or the biggest growth of their brain, and if I'm not mistaken, it's like a 75 or 80% growth from a baby size brain to the adult. That brain grows obviously the 80% that it is required. And if you look at a elephant, I think they also say it's sort of in the area of 65-70%. Same with dolphins. So it sounds like it's quite a good judge of intelligence in that line. And then if you look at something like an ostrich, the size of the brain when it hatches is pretty much almost identical to that of when it's an adult. And it's literally almost the size of my pinky nail. So with an ostrich compared to an elephant, that then very much all almost entirely instinctive behavior. With an ostrich, literally its heart beats, we just go underneath some trees. Its heart beats, it can run, and it can eat. But anything outside of that, and it's not particularly intelligent and doesn't really learn much either. Whereas an elephant, there's a whole lot more going on than heartbeat, walking, and eating. Now, we still haven't heard anything again since we heard that first roar, but we are still listening out here. And I like this conversation that we're getting going here. It's very nice. Very nice. But, it's very interesting. We had a lovely bird that flew off there. Looked like a yellow-billed stork. And off he went, unfortunately. I was looking on the ground, looking for the tracks, looking for these lions, and I missed the lovely bird up in the tree. Excuse me for that. And we've got some small critters' tracks that have been moving through, but we're looking for those big ones, the lions and the leopards. We've got white-tailed mongoose, also clawed tracks. Right, folks, so while I continue along the road looking for these leopard and lion, let's go 4,000 or 3,000 miles to the north, up to Kenya, and let's see what Taylor is up to in the Masai Mara.
Ralph, it seems as though you've had a much earlier start than I have this morning, and these elephant bulls are slowly wandering down the side of the escarpment, where I think they're going to head to the nice long grass, perhaps to the marsh, where they might also splash around. Good morning again. Welcome to today's Sunrise Safari. My name is Taylor, and on camera with me is Archie. Woo! Yeah, have you seen Archie yet? We might have to put him on camera at some point. Remember, this is live, this is interactive, and it's happening right now. So hashtag safariLIVE if you'd like to chat to us, or you can also talk to us via the YouTube chat. Now, I'm just watching very carefully, Archie, as you look at these three, because there is a fourth elephant bull. You can't see him at the moment. He's just behind the car. Now, with elephants, you do have to make sure you keep your wits about you, because they can be a bit sneaky, especially when they're at this age. And if you did join us for the Sunrise Safari yesterday, you would have seen that I had a bit of trouble with a young elephant bull from a fair way away, though. But they like to sneak up to the car and do a big trumpet and give you a fright. I don't want to have that happen, as I only have one pair of pants with me today. And I don't know if Archie's brought a spare pair, and I can tell you right now that you will get a little bit of a fright too. And they're walking straight towards us. I'm actually quite keen to see what route they take. If they're going to continue coming straight towards me, or if they're going to change direction. Now, Alicia, you're wondering, how tall do elephants get? Well, at shoulder height of a big elephant bull is normally at about 4.5 meters or so, between 4 and 4.5 meters. Oh, that was a nice little technique that elephant was using. Did you see that? He pulled out a chunk of weed and then used his foot like a spade and chopped it off and popped it in his mouth. Now, they're coming closer and closer. They look very relaxed at the moment. There is a slight swagger in their step today, but that's also because they're going downhill. And for such large animals, it's actually surprising how well they can distribute their weight. I really enjoy watching hippo, rhinoceros, and elephant going down steep slopes, and they all have different techniques as to how they get down. Elephants will sort of just go straight down. They obviously put their weight on the back of their legs, and they've got a big head and obviously big shoulders, and that's where all the weight is sitting. But if you have ever seen them, it almost looks like they sit on their bum when they go down some steep slopes. And a couple of times I have seen them slide down onto their bottom. And then rhinoceros are my favorite, particularly the white rhinos. Look at this boy, he's cheeky now. They will zigzag down steep slopes. They can't distribute their weight. Hello, yes, and now, what you gonna do? Yeah, you see that? That was quite funny, actually, how he was coming towards me, and then now he's playing soccer with a rock, and he just decided, I'm not going to come and tease Taylor today. I think he knows. He's obviously heard stories about how I take no nonsense from young elephant bulls. That must be the rumor around the Masai Mara and the Triangle. And now they've changed direction, completely going the opposite way. Now, Julia, a great question from you this morning. Are you wondering, how do you tell whether an elephant bull is in must or not? So there's a couple of things you can look for. I reckon these bulls are still a bit young to be going into must. They are bigger and more stronger bulls out here, so I think they'll suppress that sort of stage of their life for a little bit longer. But ideally, you can look at their temporal glands, but this is not a telltale sign. Don't just use it, but you can use it in conjunction with what I'll tell you next. But just behind their eyes, and it's a pity none of them are secreting at the moment, they have a gland, and it sort of dribbles an oily substance. And that's an overstimulation of adrenaline. So it can mean if they're happy, if they're excited. In this stage, they're, well, excited and I suppose a bit stressed when they go into must. But the key sign is to look between an elephant's back legs, and you'll see that he'll be dribbling urine, and normally there'll be black staining between the back of his legs as well, and they have a very, very strong smell. You'll smell them before you see them if you're downwind of the elephants. And we had a must bull yesterday morning too. He was very relaxed, but you don't take chances with those boys. You give them a bit of space, and you know, there's other elephants that you can view. My advice is always just, if you are inexperienced and you're uncertain, rather just, you know, move away. An elephant is an animal you don't want to make a mistake with, especially if you aren't able to read behavior like the trained safari guides are. They're the only ones that can turn a car over, so you want to be very, very careful. Yeah, an impala ram also just there. Now, Jamie's not too far away from me. She's just down below, approaching all the Balanites trees. And it seems as though she's got somebody wandering around on their own, and I think they've lost their mum.
Quite a sad start to our morning sunrise safari, because I agree with Taylor. I think this little chap has indeed lost its mother, because I saw it here yesterday afternoon. I know that Taylor saw it yesterday afternoon as well. And this poor little, I think a baby topi. They look so similar to baby hartebeest, but I'm pretty sure it's a topi. Or maybe it's a hartebeest. Or a topobeest. No, I'm pretty sure it's a baby topi. And I don't know why it's all on its own, but I'm amazed that it's still here after a very long, quite stormy and quite scary night. But a very good morning to all of you, and welcome to the Mara portion of the Sunrise Safari. As Taylor's told you, I'm out here with her. My name is Jamie, and this morning Manu is on camera with me for the first time in ages, Manu. It was such a nice surprise this morning when Manu jumped on the vehicle with me. Machis. Right, I have to tell you the tale of the storm yesterday, but let's go and have a look at our little baby topi. So yesterday we had a closed rehearsal for our Big Cat Week TV special that is next week on the 14th of December, for those of you in the States. And we did, Jahawi and I did, well, not very much at all. And the reason that we did not very much at all is because we were caught in the same storm that this poor little guy was caught in. Or girl. Quite difficult to tell. I think it might be a young female. Oh, there's absolutely nothing we can do with this poor little thing. We just have to hope that it manages to reconnect with the rest of its herd. I don't think it got separated in the storm, because we saw it beforehand. I don't know why it is that it's on its own. There's a herd of topi behind me, but I don't know if this little one belongs to that herd. Obviously, somehow, galloping about, perhaps in high spirits, became separated from them. But what I wanted to show you, actually, was what happened to us, what happened to Jahawi and I. Now, I've worked in places where I sort of feel as though I kind of know rain, sort of. I do not know rain like we experienced yesterday, because what happened to us was this. This is the road. This is the road next to the Angama's old lugger. Play. That's the road. We actually started to get a little bit worried we were going to get washed away. That's Jahawi telling me he thinks we're about to get washed away. It was really quite scary, and it just got higher and higher and higher and higher. It was ridiculous. I've never experienced anything like it. A flash flood on a road. Genuinely thought we were going to get washed away at one point. We wouldn't have gone far, I don't think. But you never know. Might have gone all the way down to the Mara River. All right, good luck, little one. We're going to head off and see if we can find Scar, where Taylor left him yesterday. Off you go back across to Steph in South Africa, who I believe is out on foot. I wonder what he's looking for today.
We are hot on the trails of some wild dog. Here we go. Fresh tracks of wild dog. We've heard them calling in front of us. They're just here. I'm expecting them to burst out of the bush at any second now. These animals move very quickly. They can run up to 60 kilometers an hour, and they can do that, sustain that for kilometers. And all right, I see Noelle's found them. Off you go.
So exciting. They're here. Let's look in front. I don't want you guys to not see any of this. They're busy hunting. They've been moving up and down and up and down. And with the help of two other vehicles, we've managed to get this amazing sighting for you. It's really important that we work together with all of the different game drive vehicles that are out here, because without the help of each other, a sighting like this with animals that move this way is tricky. I mean, yesterday I was by myself for a little bit trying to track them, and it was really, really difficult. Look at this beautiful view as they run down the road. Now, I'm hoping that Steph is also able to see them on foot. Yesterday afternoon, we had a really amazing scenario where between Steph and I, we were bouncing back and forth between seeing them in the vehicle as well as seeing them with Steph on foot. So I am hoping that this does happen. So you are going to hear other cars behind and around. You will see a few of them because they're guests also want to be able to see. They've seen something. I want to move forward. Do you see that? They've seen something. They're interested in something. They're possibly going to move. They're going to run down the road. Remember, like I said, bless you, Senzo. I also feel like sneezing today. Remember, like I said, because they are a little bit ADD, but also their hunting style is very different from cats. They're going to sort of bombard and then break away and work together like that. There's a hyena chasing us. Thanks, Sens. This hyena is following these dogs. I'm just going to pull off the road just a little bit so that we can see this hyena come past and have the dogs as well. So this hyena is going to run right next to our car. Oop, it stopped a little bit. Sens, can we see the hyena at all? Sorry, guys. Sorry for the aerial in the back of the car, but there's the hyena right behind us. And then as you saw, the wild dogs are right in front. This hyena is chasing them like it would chase leopard. It would follow behind leopard because it knows that the dogs are going to make a kill. But what's interesting is usually it's just one leopard and then the hyena follows. So if the dogs do make a kill, this hyena is going to be up against, I think I've counted 13, 14 dogs. This is a very cheeky hyena. Hello, sir. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. And then the hyena carries on down the road after our dogs as well. So we've got two. Sorry, everybody. I'm just going to. We've got two amazing predators in one sighting. This is absolutely fantastic. Now, if this hyena starts loping, you can actually see the back of the dog's heads just in front of where the hyena is, hopefully. Let me just stop so that Senzo can focus properly and do his magic. There we go. So hyena and dogs in one shot for you. Absolutely fantastic. Now, I want to get over the crest of this hill just a little bit so that we can see the wild dogs a little bit better. I don't want to chase the hyena off, but I also don't want to lose sight of the dogs. Oh, Jeanette, you're curious to know how many miles the dogs usually travel in a day. Jeanette, they could do 10 miles or they can do, 100 miles. It depends on how large their territory is. It depends on how full they are. It depends if they have a den. But compared to other predators, they do move in more distances. But now that's not in a straight line either. They're up and down and moving here and there. It's quite a vast distance. The longest I've ever followed wild dogs for, it was a 75,000 hectare property, so we're looking at about 180,000 acres, and we traveled over most of it, so you're looking at maybe 15 miles. Sorry, that's a really, really neat shot there. Just gonna give Sen some time. There we go. This is, now normally what I would see with wild dogs and hyena is the wild dogs would chase the hyena off, but notice the hyena is giving the dogs enough space, and then there's a little bit of a side glance here with the hyena pretending not to look at them. So sort of like, yeah, I don't really see you, so you don't really see me, and I'm just gonna give you enough space so that you leave me be. I have a feeling, two feelings. One, this hyena is optimistic about being able to get anything that the dogs kill. And two, this hyena is also busy possibly marking some territory. Now, earlier I said, hello, sir. But now that I'm looking at this hyena a little bit more, it's a little bit bigger. I actually think this is a female. A female hyena will be about 20 kilograms, so about 50 pounds heavier than a male hyena. I'm actually hoping that she just moves off the road a little bit, because as amazing as it is to have hyena and wild dogs in the same sighting, these dogs have started to move quite quickly. So, sorry, Sens. Let's see what happens. Oh, I'm so excited. Absolutely over the moon right now. Now, I'm hoping that Steph is still in our area. We are moving towards the Milwati, the dry riverbed. There we go. Thanks, hyena. That was spectacular. Now let's see where our dogs are. Right in the road up ahead. Give me 2 seconds. There they go. Coming down. All right. It's going to take me a little bit just to catch up with them. So just stick with me. Here we are. That's a beautiful shot for you, Sens. Oop, I've just got some guests behind me. I just want to position so that they can see as well. Now notice that they're smelling near that grass there. They might be smelling some hyena pastings. I'm just going to let them move, and then I'm going to pull to the side, and I'm going to let this game drive vehicle come past us so that their guests can get a good sighting and get some photos. Can't monopolize the sighting. There we are. So this is called leapfrogging when we do this, so that we get a good visual, and then they get a good visual, and then we get a good sighting, and then they get a good sighting. So we're gonna work together with them. And this vehicle that's in front of us now was the vehicle that was helping me yesterday afternoon when we were busy chasing these dogs around and around. And, you know, it's exciting for me, it's exciting for the other guides, it's exciting for the guests, and it's exciting for you. So everybody's in a super joyful, super excited mood. Ah, now they must just find some impala. Mike and David, you're curious about if the dogs could hurt or hunt the hyena. I didn't quite hear there. Oh, you're curious if the dogs would hunt the hyena to eat? No. The hyenas will eat other predators. Wild dogs in general tend not to eat other predators. These wild dogs are looking for impala, nyala. Here's the leapfrog action that we talked about. So now this vehicle got some good viewing of these wild dogs, and they found something lovely to smell there. And then they're gonna let us come past, and then we're gonna follow. I just don't wanna chase off this wild dog from what he's busy smelling. And then we'll watch a little bit, and then they'll come and go in front of us. And it's sharing. Sharing is caring. These dogs have gone south, they've gone north, they've gone east, they've gone west. We're going south, and now we're gonna go west again. See what I mean about all this crazy ADD movement. Lady Starfire, you want to know what smells worse? Hyenas or wild dogs? Wild dogs. Wild dogs smell the worst. They always stink. They stink really bad. Okay, they're going into an area that's very hard for me to follow. I'm wondering if maybe we need to turn around and possibly go down another road to try and catch them. I'm not going to be able to follow them through here. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to head straight down this way. Taxon is going to go the other way, and we'll see if we can get them again for you. So while I'm busy doing this, let's head on over to Steph, who's had a few gremlins, but I know he's got lots to share with you.
We have got a lot to show you, literally speaking, because we're on top of a massive termite mound, just trying to listen to the bush in front of us and see if we can't aid the Noel, basically, and the rest of our comrades out here in trying to relocate those wild dog. They move incredibly quickly through the bush, and sometimes when they're not walking on road, it becomes virtually impossible to follow them, except if you've got a team like us that's highly mobile and can go through these blocks and track them on the wet and soft substrate that we have here after the rain. So just have a look at the vista that we have here. And what we're listening for is alarm calls of the prey animals that these wild dog are hunting, or the contact calls that the dogs make themselves, which is this whooping noise, this quite a close frequency whoop. They are exactly where you're looking now. Somewhere in this block here, we've got one of Africa's super predators and also one of the most endangered species of large mammal and definitely large carnivore out here. Now, to me, it's incredible the way that wild dog have an effect on the bush around them. They tend to what I call bombshell an area. They'll move into an area, and because they're so active everywhere, everything scatters. Oh no, that's a dog. Everything scatters. And I was just remarking as we came out of camp today how these animals know that the wild dog go around. I mean, we were sitting having lunch yesterday, and a young Yala walked into our staff village through a gap between two rooms this big and walked into where our bathrooms are and basically sat in a little courtyard no bigger than this termite mound and waited until the dogs had passed and then left again. They know that it was safe there with us. And how this herd of impala would, the large herd of impala on top of quarantine clearings, how they'd move out of the way of these wild dog, and they didn't get caught yesterday. So, you know, it's not as easy as what you're all thinking about, or we all think it is, that wild dog catch food. They are successful a high amount of times. 90% of all the hunts that they go on, they'll actually succeed in killing something. But yesterday I was just astounded at the and previously as well, at the ability of the prey animals to get out of the way and know instinctively what to do around these wild dogs. All right, let's head off, go this way. Now, Donna, you'd like to know if it's dangerous to encounter wild dogs on foot. I've pondered this the same time. I've had very few. I've had four encounters now of wild dog on foot, and none of them have been dangerous. I haven't felt like I've been in danger, but I've watched wild dog mob leopard, and I've watched them mob hyena, and I think if you showed a little bit of weakness or you approached one of their babies or a kill that they have, I think that you could be in trouble with wild dog. They're not as scary or as intimidating as what lion or leopard are when enraged. But I'm going to hedge myself and say that I have very little experience with wild dogs on foot. And for that reason, I'm going to say I would be cautious around them, even though they don't seem to represent a threat. So my experience has been quite safe, and I've really enjoyed my time with them. I won't hesitate to engage with them on foot again. But I don't know. I need to spend more time there with them. And they're just so rare and so special to see that it becomes difficult to have an opinion on something like that, even though I've been about 2 decades this year in the bush. So, good question there. I don't know. I'm hoping that over the course of the next couple of years that we get to spend more time with these types of animals on foot. And I'll be able to tell you a bit more in years to come, you know. All right. Now, one thing I know, it's that while we are busy sniffing around in the bush over here to try and pick out something for you, that we can send you all the way north to Kenya. And Taylor's got something pretty epic to show you.
We have got a big herd of elephants. They've actually just walked right in front of the car. Now they're carrying on with their day. And it is beautiful light at the moment, and there are some big elephant cows feeding amongst the herd with all their little ones. Isn't that lovely? I'm actually quite sad. We haven't had a proper sunrise for the last few days. It's been very cloudy and overcast, as you can see, but it typically breaks. What you doing, girl? Or boy, young boy? I'm wondering. It looked like it was maybe... No, I thought it was going to have a mud bath. Oh my goodness, they just morphed into two elephants. Well, that was quite cool. And then, of course, all the little ones that looked like specks in the grass just moving along, following the adults around. Lots of little ones in this herd, that's for sure. And you can see all the flying midges as well. They're out in full force today. It's actually a little bit unpleasant. It's those biting midges. So you will hear slapping sounds coming from myself and Archie as we try and, eliminate some of these biting midges. But they don't seem to bother the elephants too much. I mean, they're not even swishing their tails around or flapping their ears, which is typically what they do when insects are around. Oh, there we go. Cue... That elephant is obviously in the show business and can understand English. She did exactly what I was talking about. So there, she's obviously being bothered quite a bit. Wow, she actually looks pregnant. Now, Yvette, you're wondering how long does it take an elephant to become a fully grown adult? So it depends on the individual, and of course it depends on male and female. Males take a lot longer to mature, and sure... When they get to about 30, 35, they're typically coming into the prime of their life and they'll be quite large, so they can get quite bigger. Females are slightly earlier. Again, it depends on the individual because each female will come into estrus at a slightly different time. So I would say anywhere between 15, maybe a little bit longer, I mean a little bit less, maybe between about 14 and about 18 years, a female elephant will become mature. But off you go back across to South Africa, where I hope the weather's a little bit better, and it seems as though the dogs are having a good day.
Oh my goodness, so they moved in a completely different direction than we were expecting, and they've killed a baby impala. The one that we're looking at right now is busy eating the head, and the hyena is still here. We're getting some great interactions between the hyena and the dogs. It's interesting because they're letting the hyena sort of stick around, and they're growling a bit at each other, but nothing really more than that. And look, the hyena's trying to look for the bits. Now, every now and then, we're going to see a dog with a collar. This particular pack has one collared dog. I believe it has to do with the fact that it has part of the imbali breakaways. Imbali is inside of Kruger National Park. I actually used to work in that concession many, many years ago. There we go. Oh, you can see them eating. And this is just a little amuse-bouche, just a little aperitif. This is nothing that's going to fill them up. Oh, there's the head. Oh my goodness, this is fantastic, everybody. Look at that. Now, a baby impala head is very squishy, and so it's easy for them to get in and crunch away. How absolutely fantastic. Oop, nope, my head. I'm going to run away with it. Oh, everyone, this is amazing. Now, I'm hoping not far from here is a lot more impala, and there's a few kudu, and I'm hoping that when they're finished with their little baby impala morsel, that they make their way sort of west, so to the back side of our screen. Look at those ones there. And so because I was saying earlier with the collar, because imbali is a little... Ooh, look at that, look at that, look at that. Did you hear those sounds? Watch, watch. How insane, everybody. How insane was that? And you can hear, and now the hyena's coming back. The hyena's like, no way. I know that you've got meat here. I'm coming back. This is incredible. This is absolutely incredible. You heard those sounds. That hyena was growling a little bit. Yes, those dogs showed him, but notice how quiet the dogs were compared to the hyena. Here comes the hyena. Yes, you're a glutton for punishment, my friend. I'm actually going to... You know, I was saying male earlier, and then... I'm going to go with female still. Oh, this is so incredible. That interaction was just too much. Absolutely too much. this is my favorite thing to see on Game Drive, is interactions between predators. I absolutely can't get enough of it. Now, the pack is moving off towards the cut line, and I would like to keep with them as long as we possibly can. So I'm going to just move. Oh, sorry, there's a stump. We have to be careful of our stumps with the Wendy's today. There's a little dip that we're going to come to just on the other side of the dam where it might be a little bit of a frozen screen, or a couple of gremlins might come through. So I'm just going to ask you just to stick with me and excuse the back of my head. It's a little bit slippery here. I just want to pay attention. And then I also just want to make sure that we get to the best spot to see them as best as I possibly can. Now, where they're going, we don't want them to go south. Put all your vibes in and say, don't go south, don't go south. We want them to go west. We want them to go where there's kudu and impala, or we just want them to go west so that they stick with us. Watch them a little bit. Just stand by with me. I'm coming around. Trying to get into the best position I can. Oh, this is too exciting. I can't even deal. Senzo, are you just so... I love it, eh? Okay. Here they are. Just a little bit. Up just a little bit more. I'm sorry for any gremlins. I hope this is okay, because we have them just here to the right-hand side. Sorry about those gremlins, guys. It's difficult. There's a little dip that we just went through, and when it's summertime and the leaves come through, for some reason the leaves bounce our signal in funny directions, but that's okay. We're back, and as long as they keep moving west, so on the right-hand side of our car and then forward, that will be the best for us. And I think they're trying to figure out where they want to go to. They're sort of just standing and eyeballing. They might even turn around and go back to the dam. You never know. You don't have... Okay, let me move up a little bit. And then we'll... ...bushes here. Sorry, guys. I know that it's a little bit hard with the picture going in and out. We are doing the best that we possibly can. Now, something that's interesting right now, yesterday when we had wild dogs, the Franklins were not alarm calling at all while they were sleeping. But this morning, because where we are near, they made a kill, which means there was alarm calls from the impalas before we got here. These Franklins are now alarm calling for them, because the predation of these guys with the impala and the alarm calls that came off are enough to set off the Franklins. Okay, now they're coming in behind me a little bit. It's not the whole pack. I would like to move just a bit so that we can get to... Oh, what are those? Sorry, we've got something else that's happening here. We have fork-tailed drongos that are dive-bombing a spot. I'm wondering if maybe I misread what was happening with the Franklins, and possibly there's another predator around. Everyone just hang tight. Franklins are going off, and the drongos are dive bombing. Did we see there, Senzo? It's entirely possible that we have something like a leopard that's here as well. I think maybe, because we still have some of the dogs that are just behind us, I just want to investigate what's happening here, because we might have something, like I said, like a leopard or a lion. I just want to have a quick little look. Could also be, oh, it's a bird of prey. I can just see it sitting there, and I promise, guys, we will turn around and go back to those dogs. Very interesting scenario. So, I was wrong about assumption with the Franklins calling because of the dogs killing that impala, and the alarm calls from the impala. Senzo, can you see through there? They're actually alarm calling because of this bird of prey that's sitting just on the branches here. It looks to me to be a Wahlberg's eagle. All right. So there we go. My assumptions were wrong. That's very cool. I'm going to turn around and head back toward... Sorry. Oh, the dogs are going back that way. So let me just turn around a little bit up this way. And we will get another view, hopefully, of our wild dogs before they go anywhere. I got very excited that there was going to be a leopard there, and we had a repeat of our Mvula and wild dog scenario. Ooh, sorry for the bumps. I'm so sorry, Wendy. I'm being very mean to you lately with these wild dogs. Do you see them, Sense? Half the pack has moved sort of this way, and half the pack is just back that way. I think let's just wait a minute and see what happens. I'm trepidatious to, there they are, they're coming up the road. I'm trepidatious to move down the hill any farther because I don't want to lose picture with any of you. So we are going to try, there we go. And then they're going back towards the dam. There we are, running. All right, I think for now where I'm gonna have to, be, look, it's, oh, there they come back again. Yeah, it's a tough one. I'm thinking maybe I'm going to have to do a little bit of maneuvering that's going to cause our picture to go away too much. So I think just, nope, now they're coming back down the road again. I think let's head on over to Ralph with his hyena while I try and get to the best area possible to show these wild dogs to all of you. I'm sorry about the up and down, but that's how they move. Let's head on over to Ralph.
Thanks, Noelle. Yes. Apparently, folks, this is the same hyena. Now, excuse my head in the way there. This is the same hyena that I think was just chased off by those wild dogs. Now, they've moved quite a big area already because we're not very close to where Noelle is. Now, I'm just going to reposition that. We can watch this hyena walking down the road. Oopsie, sorry, VM. He's obviously just walking towards where Noelle and the wild dogs have gone. And I think he's also going to walk off the road there in the same direction. So nice to see that everybody's running around after the wild dogs. I think we're going to leave them to continue along that line. We're still combing along the edge boundary. We're heading up now towards Biffle's Hook. And while I was heading up, I was actually thinking a little bit better along the lines of instinctive behavior or learned behavior, which can then become instinctive behavior. And something that I thought of watching some impala as we were driving along was that of impala and antelope or plains game as a whole. You know, humans would have in thousands of years ago maybe not been such a threat to animals, and they possibly wouldn't have been as scared of us, but through predation and through hunting they obviously learned that we have that we are a dangerous species. So I think that kind of learned behavior now through thousands of years of us hunting wild animals or game, they have now instinctively, young impala, when they are born, if I step out of the vehicle they will run away instinctively, whereas a young nyala calf could walk past and it wouldn't bat an eyelid. So I think that's quite a good example of learned behavior that has now become instinctive. So we will be looking for all sorts of different examples. James asking a very good question. What are some of the most unusual learned behavior that I've seen? Well, there are some crazy birds, I think, that have learned to use all sorts of different ways of hunting, and like the black egret, using that wing style where they make a bit of shade, and then the little fish come underneath and they then stab it with their beak. So that's quite, I think, also a learned behavior that now has crossed over to being instinctive. That quite unusual. Now another one also being with the primates and baboons in particular, where they can take a piece of stick and they push it into a termite mound, firstly having broken a little bit open, and then they have learnt that if they put a stick in there, the soldier termites or the defenders of the nest, they'd all come and try and attack the piece of grass and latch onto it, and then they can pull that piece of grass out and eat it, or eat all the termites off like a lollipop. So that's quite strange, but also fascinating and very clever, very. For me, quite intelligent, learned behavior that later does become instinctive. But the little baboons would have to watch the adults to show them what has been done there, and then they would later do that. Now, another example is also like the elephants learning the ancient paths between distant waterholes or food sources. They would definitely not have initially known that without having been taught by the older adults and more like the matriarchs and the old bulls, showing them the roots and also where the sources are in times of change. So that is very interesting, and I'm sure you would have seen that instinctive behavior of the wildebeest and zebra to be migrating across the Masai Mara. Very, very interesting there. So there's a lot of different examples that we can think of, and please keep sending them through. Send through ones that you have, and keep asking any other questions that you may have to do with learned behavior or instinctive behavior. Very interesting. So we're still trying to learn about where the predators are. We know where the wild dogs are, and Noel seems to have that covered. We are just still combing the perimeter, excuse me, to see if we can find them. But I think in the interim, Noel has relocated and would like to show you those wild dogs once more.
Everyone, we are so lucky. Half of the pack has gone south over Little Gowrie. So Little Gowrie is a place where we can't drive, but then half of them are still here by Twin Dams, which means we can stay here. Now they're calling, and to my front end, I can hear other dogs answering. So, I mean, we've seen about 12 or 14 dogs this morning, but I don't think this is the full pack. I think part of the pack was possibly still hunting a little bit farther away from us. So we might just get lucky and be able to hear and see them doing that amazing call. They were doing it a minute or so ago. I'm just happy that they've decided to stay where we can view them, and we can view them so nicely. And also that they're sitting put for a little bit. So, I mean, it's super exciting and super fun when we listen. Responds. Listen. No, it's too far away. We can't hear. But did you see how closely they put their faces to the ground? And that's so the sound magnifies off. That is, oh, too much, everybody, too much. Can you all see why I love wild dogs so much? Yeah, Lou, I agree. It also gives me goosebumps. I'm just over the moon with the amount of action we've had with these wild dogs in the past couple of days. And this morning, this light, because there's hardly any clouds in the sky, this light is so beautiful. You can see the blood on this one's face. This is the collared one that we were talking about earlier. Because of the amount of blood that is here, I would imagine that this is possibly the one that either took down the impala lamb or got the lion's share. Oh, there they move. There they're going. They're chasing the hyena, Senzo says. They're chasing the hyena. I'm going to do my best to turn around and get us to where we can see them. Do you see how quickly anything can happen with these dogs? Just like this, and they're gone. Completely gone. Crazy. It's going to be super bumpy. My best to get you over there. We might get a little bit of gremlins here and there. Sorry. Just coming down. Hopefully they move towards the pans. I actually think way where we can't see them. No, but let's just hold on. Maybe we get lucky and they come to these little them. Maybe we get lucky. Okay, so where I'm facing is where we can't move into. It's the little gallery property. They've run, as Senza was saying, they were chasing the hyena, so now the whole pack has moved this way, but as we've seen from this morning, they go up and down and up and down and up and down. So right now, we can't see them, but that doesn't mean that they might not come back to where we can see them. So my plan for right now is to give it a couple of minutes and see if they come back. I'm just chuffed that we got the chasing with the hyena just now, but then also the interaction with the hyena earlier and all those sounds we got, the contact calling that you heard with them with that whoo, 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 the impala head eating. I mean, it's been a fantastic morning so far with them. So definitely we're gonna sit here and we're gonna see if they're gonna come back, because the chances they come back are pretty good. So while we are busy waiting for these wild dogs to reappear, I think the best thing we can do is let's head on up to Jamie, who's got another predator that she would like to show you far up north in the Maasai Mara in East Africa.
Hello to the lions indeed, and what an amazing sighting you have had with Noel and those dogs. I really miss wild dogs. I really, really do. I wish we saw them more often here in the Mara. Though, while they've been busy, while the Djuma crew's been busy with a pack of dogs, we are with a mating pair of lions. And in this case, looks like Morani, pretty sure that's him, and one of the Mogoro lionesses, so in the Mogoro drainage line, essentially. So one of the four... hold on. Here we go, let's see if they... a bit of growling already. Got a headache, leave me alone. Rejected. Oof. Has it been a long night, you two? I know, girl. I know. So, one of the four musketeers, obviously the coalition that Scar belongs to, apparently he was around here yesterday, and we came across here to search for him, but we found Morani instead with his lioness. Apparently there's two mating pairs. I think it's Sikio mating with the other lioness, I'm not sure. Apparently Scar didn't get lucky at all this time around, but that's how it works with male lion coalitions. And in fact, just because Morani has started mating with this female now doesn't mean he's going to still be mating with her in a few days' time. So for our new viewers, a female's estrus, or heat cycle in lions, lasts for about 5 days, five, sometimes seven in really extreme cases, but usually around 5 days. And during that time, they will roughly, well, on average, mate every 15 or so minutes, so about four times an hour, sometimes more, sometimes less. Obviously, if it's really, really hot, it gets hot during the day, they're going to be less inspired, as you can imagine. So the whole process is actually quite draining on both the female and the male, and most of the time they do not eat, unless something walks under their noses and they catch it, or there happens to be an existing kill. Most of the time they will ignore food, and as a result, by the end of a few days, they're actually quite weak and quite exhausted, which is why it's entirely possible that a Scar could come, potentially, it doesn't have to be Scar, could come in and take over from his brother at some point. So male lion coalitions, every male lion in a coalition will get his chance to mate with a female. Because their territories include several different prides, several different females, there's not as it's not as serious a battle between coalition members. It's not like with cheetah, where if a female is an estrus, it's a rare thing. The opportunity to mate and pass on their genetics is unusual. So for them, it often descends into quite a serious scrap between coalition members. Whereas for male lions, they do fight. They do fight over females, but it's usually not too serious. At the moment, though, they seem to be seriously unenthused by this whole situation. Camera shy? I don't think so. Not these lions, not in this area. I'm pretty sure this is the same lioness I saw taunting hyenas a good few weeks ago. She's very clever. It was very, very entertaining. Well, speaking of entertaining animals, since owls are currently fast asleep, let's go across to Taylor, who's found a group of animals that are much more likely to be much more active.
They are indeed, Jamie, and they're bounding around at the moment. I think if a mongoose could smile, it most certainly would after all the rain. And these banded mongoose are foraging at the moment. They're very, very excited. The ground is nice and soft. It's very saturated. And, well, it seems as though the mongoose are also saturated. They haven't quite dried off. Perhaps their burrow got a little bit on the damp side. So I'm sure they'll appreciate the sun when it comes out. Now, they're looking for a number of different things. You can see that nose is working overtime. And also their ears. They'll be listening to see if they can hear anything moving amongst the grass, but they've got very sharp claws, so they can dig into the mud. And with the ground being so soft, you'll probably find that they'll be able to eat a lot more efficiently today rather than spending a few minutes on digging through hard soil. And they'll be looking for grubs, so larvae of a variety of beetle species. They'll be looking for grasshoppers. They'll be looking for lots of different things, scorpions, even the odd snake, though I don't think there'll be a snake out at this time. It's a bit too early and a little bit chilly. There they go. I wonder if this is this group that I see, because they're very relaxed. They don't seem to mind the car at all. Remember I had that amazing sighting along the edge of the marsh and the forest of the mongoose going in and out of a termite mound? We're quite close to that specific spot. So I wonder if it's the same family. But they're very busy. And there's a few of them. Oh, there we go. Digging in some dung. That'd be a good place to look, especially for lots and lots of dung beetles. There should be plenty of them in there. Let's see if it's going to be successful and find anything. Looks like it's looking for something. And you know, even just the odd tiny little beetle, like the little spider dung beetles, that'll be fine. They'll all add up eventually. Off they go. Now, Kathy, you're wondering how big these mongoose are. And it's actually quite interesting. So I have to say this. I'm so sad that I have seen one up close. One was hit by a car, and I moved it off of the road, and I was really surprised to see how large they are, because when you stare at them, they don't look particularly big. And the one that I picked up and moved was a fully grown adult. It must have been half a meter in length. Maybe no, I speak utter nonsense. Probably closer to a meter with its tail. I must just double check. I will have a look in my book. Okay, let's do that. Let's get the exact measurements. But I would say with its tail, they're almost a meter in length, maybe just shy of that. And actually, somebody else wants to say a few things. Have a little listen. The frogs, obviously, and toads want to steal the show today. They obviously don't want me to say anything, so we're sitting in the marsh. Oh, okay, let me sit quietly again. I don't think you heard it. Now they've stopped. Typical of the mongoose of the frogs. I think they might have just realized that we're sitting here. So I'm just quickly paging through my book because I'm trying to find banded mongoose. But of course, nothing is ever easy, is it? No, Egyptian mongoose. No, that's not the one we're looking for. Slender mongoose. No, now we're on civets. Why does my book not have banded mongoose? That is bizarre. Now, I'm sure all of you could probably do it a lot quicker than I could, paging through this book and just pop it in on the interweb to see about their sizes and their length. And their weight, it was quite heavy. I actually ended up using two hands. I picked it up by its tail and then I just moved it off the road so somebody would have eaten it. I'm so sorry, everybody. For the life of me, I cannot find... I've got everything else in this book except banded mongoose. Why can I not find a banded mongoose? Maybe one will just come running over here and then I can pick it up. It's a couple of kilograms, though. I mean, that's honestly ridiculous. No, I don't have banded mongoose in this book. What a silly book. Oh, no, a lie. It's not a silly book. It's the best book in the whole world. I found it. I was just silly. Here we go. Now we've got to look. So, yes, in total... Yeah, about 70 centimeters or so in length. I thought they looked a lot longer than that. Honestly, when I picked up that adult, I was surprised as to how big it was. So maybe I just picked up the largest banded mongoose in the whole wild. Well, it wasn't a white-tailed mongoose, that's for sure. I promise I can tell the difference between the two. Let's see, if does it talk about a weight at all? 1 to 2 kilograms. I feel as though they're a little bit heavier than that. Obviously, it's a bit difficult unless you've gone and actually weighed some of these creatures and you'll know the exact weights. And all books are slightly different. They all vary. But it was quite big when I picked it up. And I definitely thought it was a bit longer than just 70 centimeters. I mean, 70 centimeters is two rulers put together plus a third of a ruler. And that's not very big. But they really were. They were surprising how large they were. And I think a little bit heavier than 2 kilograms, maybe a little bit more than that. The one that I picked up was definitely slightly bigger. But let me move forward because they're running quite far away from us now. Whee! And it's very slippery. Archie and I have been having a lot of fun this morning slipping and sliding about. It's been quite cool. That's actually why we've come to the marsh, is because we thought we'd do some mudding this morning. Let's try to go slowly through here. There's a few bumps. Okay, we'll have one last look of the mongoose as they race around, and I think it is the same family that I've seen on a regular basis. Unfortunately, no one was successful in picking up any scraps. But Steph is, of course, on bushwalk, as you know. He's a lot closer to the ground. Perhaps he can find you something that these mongoose would like to eat.
Perhaps I could, although we're having the same problem that that Taylor's having today, and that we're treading carefully so that we don't get stuck. And it's been quite interesting. The last couple of hours we've been following around those wild dogs, unfortunately not seeing them, but coming very close, and then they're moving away. Very active things. And to stay up with them today has been, we've walked a lot today. I think we're going to sit and enjoy our breakfast. This I wanted to show you because this is the biggest num-num that I've seen at Djuma, and one of the largest num-nums that I've ever seen outside or inside of the park ever. It is massive. Normally they're these tiny little bushes, and this one here is an old grandfather num-num. This thing has been here for generations, and we're lucky enough to see some of its flowers. So I'm going to pluck one of its flowers here for you so I can show you what they look like. Because they really are a treat. They make this tiny little spray of white flowers. Let me put that there for you. There's the white flowers there. And what makes them so fantastic is their smell. These are one of the most powerfully smelling flowers that we find out here, and an absolute treat this time of the year. It is the most citrusy, lemony smell that you've ever smelt. Oh, that is fantastic. Wow. So I don't want to sniff too hard because I'm going to sniff this thing to the empty cavity where my brain is supposed to be. Oh, yeah. So, just for a few of you who may have missed this plant, this is the num-num, N-U-M-N-U-M. The genus is Carissa. And the species is Bispinosa. So Carissa Bispinosa, and it gets the Bispinosa name because of that Y-shaped thorn that you can see there between my fingers. So the Carissa with a C, Bispinosa, or the num-num. Really awesome smelling plant. And they've been cultivated all over South Africa. Cuttings have been taken from the wild, and they plant them into hedges where outside of the parks, where you have a lot of water and a lot of sunshine and you cut it a lot, you can actually get this into a hedge, and they make a fantastic security barricade. Because once the old sticks dry out, you can see here that that soft thorn that was soft ends up being a very hard woody thorn that it is a deterrent for, you know, miscreants. Another thing that is flowering at the moment is all this osimum, and this also has a superb smell. This is osimum canum, or the wild basil, and it has a delicious smell, but have a look at how exquisitely delicate that flower is. Glad to know that I don't have any shakes this morning. Well, not much. Give me the rest of the day. By this afternoon, I'll be shaking around like a leaf in the wind. But isn't that, how delicate is that? That's a fully formed flower and will be pollinated by something equally as small. And you can see from the fact that the anthers are at the bottom of the flower, those are those yellow globules, and that they're quite far away, that this particular flower attracts a very special insect with a long skinny face. And the pollen is then deposited on the bottom of the insect. So the insect would come and hover, and then as they go in to feed on the nectar, they'd get dusted on their thorax. And that is how this particular flower spreads its... Sorry, there was just a... These wild dog are creating chaos in this area, and we're just hearing noises, hyena making noises, monkeys panicking. That was some impala having an issue. It sounded like something like a lion or a leopard, but it was definitely impala. These osimums now, when you roll them up in your hands, and they make for lovely summertime decorations, they've got a licorice and aniseed smell. So the smell that I'm smelling now is a very powerful aniseed-y smell mixed with the citrus that I have on my fingers from the carissa behind me. Oh, yeah, that's lovely. And you can take this wild basil, as they call it, or this osimum, and you can take sticks and leaves, and then you rub it on your legs as a deterrent for ticks and flies hung upside down in a kitchen. Hanging like this in a kitchen above where you prepare food will be a deterrent for flies, and has been used for ages out here as a covering for fresh corpses to keep flies away. Obviously there are no morgues around here, and so when people die and before they bury them, they have to keep them as many insects away as they can, and they coat the bodies in these leaves. It makes a very nice coating and it smells nice. But it also is a fly deterrent, and so it keeps the flies away from people. Another flower here. Perry, you'd like to know if either of the plants that I've just shown you are edible. In actual fact, Perry, they are. This osimum you can use as a delicious herb for cooking with. So particularly for mutton or for goat or for impala. It makes a fantastic herby covering. And then this one, the carissa, produces a red fruit. And when it's ripe, the fruit will be about this big. And an absolutely delicious, milky sweet fruit. So both are edible, in actual fact. So thank you for asking me that. This is another very delicate flower called Evolvus Elsinoides, and it's not fully formed just yet. I'm waiting for a blue one to come out, or blue haze, and it gets the common name haze from the fact that it's got all these furry bits on, and when you look at it from the side, it can look like the side of the stem is hazy, and it can end up in quite large fields of growth as well. Right, we're going to carry on here and see if we can catch up with these manic dogs, and you're off to Ralph to see what he's been up to.
Thanks, Steph. Yeah, and for the moment, we're still on the road, still trying to find out, to catch up with some predators. It seems that those lions have given us the slip. I think that it sounded a little bit closer than they actually were. Sorry for the bumps. As we go along, you can see it's very muddy on the road, so we do need to go a little bit slowly. And we stay in the same tracks all the time, because we don't want to make a million different roads as we move through, because then when it does dry, it's gonna have that effect of having a lot of different roads, and it does cause quite a bit of erosion after such time as well, because then you've got a lot of different streams running through when the water flows. So we've taken the whole outer boundary on the northeastern side and moved up Biffle's Hook area, and now we've sort of cut through into the drainage lines and sort of towards the little river pockets. And there's a little group of impala, a little young one, and I don't know if these animals are still doing what they were doing earlier, because we were looking at the hair, especially on the little youngsters, and it was very fluffed out this morning, and I think there you can see that it still is. Now that's another nice example of instinctive behavior. It's very evident on the Nyala bulls. It's called piloerection, and most mammals do this, if not all. It's an instinctive behavior or reaction to cold weather. Now, raising the hair, with the Nyala, they obviously do it in display, but with all mammals, you raise the hair, and it does help to trap warm air in between the hair follicles. So you can see it, especially with the youngster who is more exposed or more easily exposed to cold weather. They're nice, fluffy, almost very baby-like, thicker fur that they have assists in keeping them warm. And you can see that now with this, and a lovely stretch there as well. Lovely to see that after all these days of rain, and they would have been quite cold, they're now obviously enjoying this morning sun and stretching and getting themselves nicely warmed up. So I'm sure even this little youngster will be quite happy that, yes, we did have the rain, but it's over now for the time being, and he can start to warm up. And he survived the night as well, which is always a bonus. So let's continue on down the road here. We are on the lookout for any of these leopards. We are in the area of where we think Tandi might be, but we won't be going anywhere near there just for the minute. We're just keeping a close eye on that den, and obviously there is protocols around that. Not everybody allowed to just move into that area, so it's a little bit of a closed zone, and with it being very wet now at the moment, it would obviously be a bad decision to go down there now. So I won't be going down anywhere near her den, but we are on the road past and in the area where she has been seen moving around, so there's always that possibility. But we will have a look. There might be some other males in the area. There has been some moving through, so you just keep looking. Now, I know I've spent most of the morning driving around, but very often that can happen on game drives. That's why it's called as such. Right, so I'm continuing to drive around like this, and hopefully I'm going to be able to come back very soon with something absolutely exciting. But in the meantime, let's go over to Noelle and see what she's up to.
Ralph, I'm lurking. I'm lurking on the boundary between us and Little Gowrie, and I'm listening to these wild dogs going, whoo, 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 whoo. And they're doing exactly to the guys in Little Gallery what they're doing to us, which is moving up and down and up and down. They killed another impala lamb over there. Again, it's just a little amuse-bouche, just a little aperitif. It's nothing big. We've got an impala that's in front of us here, a male impala, and oh, he's moved off, Senzo says. But it looks like he's either listening or has seen something. And from the audio, the sounds, sorry, I always say audio. I'm speaking game drive talk. I'm so sorry about that. From the sounds we can hear, from the calling we can hear from the dogs, they're probably 400 meters in this direction from us and moving a little bit west. So I'm cherry picking and I'm lurking because I'm convinced that they're going to come back to where we can see them. And because they are my favorite predator and because we don't get to see them all the time, I don't really want to leave the area. And because they're hunting as much as they are, I'm really keen to just sort of sit put. We can barely see our little impala in there. And then just to give you all an update on one of your favorite cats, Shadow has made a kill inside of this area that we're looking at here. I'm not quite sure exactly where, but she's in there, so she's still doing well. And I haven't heard an update on her youngster, but I'm going to make the assumption that the youngster is fine in that scenario. Now, I haven't heard any lion calling this morning. I haven't heard any updates for Cheetah. A lot of the other game drive vehicles, just like us, have been focusing on these wild dogs. Again, it's a very, very special sighting. So we have time now. If you'd like, please send through some questions or some comments, hashtag SafariLIVE on Twitter, or you can ask us questions on a YouTube chat. And you know I love chatting with all of you, so let's see if we can get any discussions flowing. And don't forget, 14th of December, 10 p.m. Eastern in the States is our live show on Nat Geo Wild. So while I am busy waiting to see, well, I'm waiting, I am lurking, I'm like a little peeping Tom of the bush, let's head on up to Jamie and the Maasai Mara, who has some lions she would like to show you.
As you can see, our lions have been, well, extraordinarily enthusiastic about the start of this day. They did get up and mate a few moments ago, but with the wild dogs and everything that's been happening on Djuma this morning, and it just wasn't particularly exciting, but they are going to get up and mate again at some point, so we're sticking here for a little bit longer. But while we wait for them to resume their amorous activities, I know that we've spoken about this before, but for viewers that perhaps missed those safaris, Taylor and I have been playing while we've been out and about with the two of us out from the Mara, and essentially we come up with a word before drive. And now, although my social media usage is relatively limited, Taylor tells me that there were certain viewers who came up with this game initially, and they put a word in that then Taylor and Tristan would try and sneak into the drive. So what we've done is I've sort of shamelessly stolen that idea. That's not to say that they cannot continue to play that game. Absolutely they can. But what Taylor and I, we've come up with the idea of choosing a word of the day between us, and we try and slip it into every drive. So we might have already said it. We may not have already said it. You don't know. We'll say it three times each in the course of a drive. Today's word is a noun. And it's not an animal. So we're not going to, or grass or a tree or something that we would say in the course of an everyday drive. So it's not going to be something like lion, for example. That wouldn't work out very well at all. So see if you can guess, hashtag SafariLIVE on Twitter, what Taylor and I have chosen as the word of the day today. In constant communication with each other. Have you said it yet? Have you said it yet? Very entertaining. We find it quite entertaining. Especially because the last two words that we chose, we both struggled to actually use in sentences without it being really odd. So I think we've gone with something more natural. Ah, good morning to Sky, who is wondering about the hormones of the lions. Now, Sky's wondering if if the lions experience a hormone spike that causes the urge to mate repeatedly, or is it learned behavior, or where it come from? So essentially, yes, there is a hormone spike. They're obviously, just like with every mammal that ovulates or is preparing to ovulate, there are changes in the balance of the various hormones, not just estrogen and progesterone, luteinizing hormones, and what's the other one? LTH, I'll remember. Anyway, so the female's body goes certain changes. The male picks up on those changes through scent and behavior as well. The female gets a little bit flirtatious and starts to scent mark and call and so on. So the male responds to that. Now, what the interesting thing about lion mating and leopard mating is that in this particular instance, nature has created a way of inducing ovulation. So essentially, the repeated mating, while her hormone levels are there, the repeated mating is necessary in order to stimulate the release of the eggs. So that comes instinctively. They just naturally know that they need to mate repeatedly. As I'm sure most of you know, the male's penis is barbed, and that in turn, the discomfort caused to the female, as unpleasant as it may be for her, is what actually ultimately results in the release of the eggs and therefore fertilization. I've struggled in the past to figure out exactly what hormone changes occur with that discomfort that caused the release of the eggs, but essentially that is one reason why they mate repeatedly. And that's nature's way of ensuring that when it does come time to fertilize the eggs, she's actually mating with the biggest, strongest male around, or at least it's almost a safeguard. So let's say she happened to find a young male and she starts mating with him because she's an estrus. And the sound of it attracts the territorial male. He comes in, he chases the young male away, and he completes the whole mating process and is responsible for the cubs. But it's even cleverer in that now she has ensured the safety of her cubs, but all the males that have mated with her will assume that the cubs are theirs, so they're less likely to kill them. Now, obviously, there's a natural instinct for a male lion to kill an underage cub. There is a sort of a cutoff point, but it's always a very fine line. But the natural instinct of a male lion is to kill a young lion that is not theirs. Morning, everyone. Okay, so we've had some luck this morning out here in the Mara. We might not have had wild dogs, but we have had a lion extravaganza. Taylor's found some more for you. Off you go.
We have indeed. Have a little listen very quickly. Turn the volume right up.
Move.
You hear all that? Baboons, topi, everybody's alarm calling this morning. So while the lions walk past, let's have a quick look. So the baboons are up in that tree over there that has been browsed nicely by the giraffe. So they're shouting. And what actually alerted me to these lions was not the baboons, but the topi police. And the topi is just standing here off to the right. And you can see it's standing up on a little bit of a termite mound. Now it's bronking off and running away. And what caught my attention was that topi stopped and turned very quickly, just as it's done now. And I knew straight away that something was lurking in the forest. It was all too good to be true. And we had some very skittish impala. And I was wondering what on earth was going on. But now we know. I'm going to reposition for you very quickly because it's actually quite a beautiful scene that we've got at the moment. I'm just going to do this. Because look at all the animals starting to line up to watch the lions. You've got waterbuck, zebra, there's even a couple of elephants, but they don't seem to be too bothered by the alarm calls. And now that everybody knows that these lionesses are here, these two girls who hang around the marsh, I'm not sure what their names are. I think they're a breakaway from somewhere. But they're beautiful girls, and I often enjoy spending time with them. But all the animals are watching the lions now. Now, we are in a non-off-roading area, so if they do head out a little bit further than they go now, we'll have to zoom around and try and find a road that cuts in between. Hopefully there is one. Otherwise, we're going to be watching these cats from a very, very far way away. They actually look hungry. They don't look like they've eaten anything just recently, maybe something small.
Perhaps they're going to be on the hunt in a little bit. Right now, though, they haven't really got a chance at all. Everybody knows that they're here. Everyone's alarming, shouting, lions, lions, lions. So they'll have to move into a new area. Well, there are lots and lots of warthogs. And then that lioness to the right, she's walking towards the warthogs. You might be able to see there the warthogs run. And we came around the edge of the forest that side, and it was like warthog heaven. There were burrows everywhere. There were warthogs coming out of the burrows. Now, if they decide to go in them, we might get lucky and watch these lionesses try and dig one out, because you can see her behavior has changed now. Look how those ears are all pricked forward. I think she's keen. You know what we think might have to do, Archie? We might actually have to go all the way back to where we started this morning and come around that way, because that's where it looks like she's headed. And then we'll have a much closer sort of view. Wonderful. But before we do anything exciting, we'll have to reposition and travel quite a fair distance. Otherwise, we're not going to make it. I think that's what we're going to actually have to do. Let's do that now, rather sooner than later. I need to go all the way back down to where those warthogs are. Remember, I can't just go off-roading in this area. Although, even if I could off-road, I wouldn't off-road here because it is a marsh. So please bear with me. It'll take me a fair amount of time to get around again, but we'll just keep going there. Nice. Happy to find some lions. Just turn that up. Okay. Now it's all starting to make sense as to why they were excited. Just keep checking the forest to see if there's any more cats or anything else hiding away in the tall trees. Okay, so we've got a bit of a distance to cover to try and catch around. I'll try and do it as quickly as I can. I think you're going to go back to South Africa now. On to the bushwalk with Steph, and I wonder what other cool creatures he's got.
We've got a Wahlberg's eagle in the top of a tree there, and after a lot of rain like we've had yesterday and today, it's not uncommon to find large birds of prey sitting in the tops of trees, sunning themselves and drying out their feathers. And it's because birds have a very narrow tolerance for weight gain, or weight loss for that matter of fact. Too heavy and they become lethargic. This is in terms of food now. Too heavy and they become lethargic, too light and they become too frantic, and they actually become too weak to hunt. And so birds have to keep themselves in a band of weight that is actually quite narrow. And a hungry, heavy bird will burn a lot more energy and will run the risk of falling off of a nutrition precipice to a point where they won't be able to hunt enough. And it's not uncommon for us to find birds lying dead after prolonged periods of cold weather or rain, especially at the beginning of a season like this where food is still pretty scarce. What actually brought us up to this particular lip of this drainage line in front of us is the fact that quite a few of the Shire forest birds were sitting in this thicket in front of us and were sunning themselves as well. Now, by Shire forest birds, I'm talking about green-winged petilia, twin spots, somber bulbuls. What other ones are all your widow finches? They all these secretive birds that come out, eremomela. They're all these secret birds that come out, secretive birds that come out and will sun themselves. And it's really the only time you get to see them. But of course, because I've wanted to show you, they have